We're going to kick off. Welcome to Cornell University. I'm Bob Balder. I'm the executive director here for the College of Architecture, Art, and Planning. And on behalf of Dean Ken Kleiman, who could not be with us this evening, I welcome you. And for those that have been or been here before, you've probably heard me talk a little bit about the building that we're in, but I think it stands to some rationale that we're in the old historic Standard Oil building. And we've been fortunate to have moved in and finished our fit out just about a year ago. So we're very excited to finally be in this space. And one of the programs that we have at Cornell is to make sure that we engage and really show our community side. On the other end of the floor, you'll see a lot of our architects that are here. Some of them may wander in, but I want to make sure that everyone feels welcomed here. We have restrooms down the hallway here, and if you have any other special needs, please let me know. The sound system that we have, can you hear us in the back all right?
Yeah.
Great. We're really fortunate to be a partner in this exercise of being able to host the Waterfront Alliance and see some of our old friends that have worked with us over the years. And it's a great honor to have you here, and I really look forward to the presentations and the discussion. And we'll obviously be doing this for the next after tonight, there'll be four more Wednesdays that we have featured here, and then we'll also be hosting a number of Cornell-related events. So we'll be posting those typically on the Architect's Diary, so keep an eye out for that. So without any further ado, I want to make sure that I get a chance to introduce our Chief Operating Officer for the Waterfront Alliance and an old biking partner, Doug Adams, who's with us, who's tonight wearing his Waterfront hat, but in an earlier iteration on some Cornell outings, we had bike helmets on. So Doug, thank you so much for being here, and we look forward to tonight's presentations.
Sir.
Thank you, Bob, and an additional thanks to Cornell University and Bob for hosting the Deep Dive speaker series. Thank you all for coming tonight. It's exciting to see such a great turnout, which really speaks to the interest in our shared waterfront and the mission of the Waterfront Alliance to protect, transform, and revitalize the waterfronts and waterways of New York City and northern New Jersey. I'd like to thank our sponsors, Arcadis and AKRF, for their generous support, without which the Deep Dive speaker series would not be possible. A few quick housekeeping items. In keeping with our digital theme tonight, we're going to have a bit of audience participation via your smartphones. You can go ahead and get ready for that by going to the website that's listed on the flyer, which is govote.at. Again, that's govote.at. If you want Wi-Fi access, the network is Red Rover, and that's Red Rover, and it doesn't require a password. I think it just requires you to plug in your email address. Tonight is the second of the six deep dives, which are running each Wednesday through May 4th. Don't forget to register online for the others. The deep dives are a prelude to our annual waterfront conference, which is held on May 12th. It's the conference on the boat. Really great. You can register for that online as well. If you're interested in sponsoring the conference, please see me tonight. And lastly, we're seeking applications for our Waterfront Scholars Program, also sponsored by Arcadis. This will provide scholarships for up to 100 undergrad and grad students to attend the conference for free. Please help us spread the word on that. There's flyers out front of the registration table. Carter Kraft is moderating tonight's deep dive. Carter is a senior economic officer with the Consulate General of the Netherlands in New York. He's an avid boater and board member of the Hoboken Community Boathouse. Carter was director of the Waterfront Alliance when we got our start many years ago, and he's taught at Pratt, Fordham, and NYU, where he was one of my professors back in the day. Carter, take it away.
Hey, good evening, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Digitizing. I'll keep my remarks short so you can really hear from the people that you want to hear from. But when we think about digitizing, I want to expand that metaphor to also think about our fingers and our toes. Because ultimately, the work that our panel is doing across communities, across activities, across profession and recreation, is all about helping the collective us to immerse ourselves and the great opportunities that the not just the waterfront, but the water really represent. When we started talking about this panel back with Jose and others back in December, we were talking about how is data used? How are people persuaded? How is policy changed and improved? How does policy change lead to the physical change that this whole community of which you're a part is so focused on? Years ago, when we started the Waterfront Alliance in the late 90s, you know, we relied on traction, or we got a little traction, initially with the anecdotal. You know, I saw a guy at the end of Tiffany Street in Hunts Point, and he and his friend and his wife sitting under the umbrella were pulling up crab after crab at the western end of Long Island Sound. And an early volunteer with the Point CDC speaking to them in Spanish said, "Do you know if that's clean or safe enough to eat?" He'd shoved the crab in his mouth and shrugged his shoulders. And his wife laughed and the kid kept playing. You know, that was 1998. Soon we realized we need pictures. So we started documenting, and we had a communications relationship with Gotham Gazette and others to try to add a little more image, a little more texture, so that people, so that the then city council members and others who were getting interested could actually see it's not just the stories we're telling, it's what your constituents are doing. And it was when we saw the same community of sustenance people fishing on Newtown Creek at the end of Manhattan Avenue, pulling in blue crab after blue crab and dropping it in a bucket, you know, it helped a lot with then David Yaski, who was chair of the formative city council committee on waterfronts, to say, wow, this is a problem. He could feel it. He could see it. But that was just one city council member, and I don't want to go into the anecdote too long because, you know, the story goes on. And the story became, well, yeah, it's a public health risk. But when we would meet with the Parks Department, they'd say, well, and, you know, that's a health department role. Maybe they should pay for the sign. And the health department would say, well, yeah, it's our rule, but that's Parks Department's property. Maybe they should pay for the sign. So it was kind of the runaround bureaucratic bullshit for a number of years, which many of us still get. And even though I work now for a foreign government, they let me say what I really think about processes in the United States that continue to this day. But from anecdotal to imagery, you know, then that was the early days of GIS. So we were able, working with Steve Romilevsky at NYPIRG and the Community Mapping Assistance Project, to update the cities on knowledge of how much waterfront there was. You know, they've been using since Alex Garvin took a piece of string back in 1972 and identified, wow, we think there's 578 miles of waterfront. With formative GIS and map info, which doesn't even exist anymore, we found, well, that's actually 532 miles of waterfront. So imagine being the group that goes in to meet with Mayor Giuliani's planning department to tell them that they're responsible somehow for losing 46 miles of precious waterfront in New York City. Along came GIS. Fast forwarding to, you know, today, you know, it's not just data, it's how we use it. It's the methodology through which agencies assemble it and use it, and the agencies that measure their compliance and performance. And the great thing about the advocacy and policy and design work here tonight is it's data for the sake of citizen science, public education, and database project advocacy, generating, you know, we're beyond the days of relying on the data that's given to us, and we're in the days when we have to generate our own data to make our case and to persuade not just the people who need to be persuaded, but like that Dr. Seuss book from planning school, persuading the persuaders so they can persuade the persuaders that need to be persuaded. It's not an easy task pushing some of these particularly new initiatives uphill. So I will do, we're going to get straight into the presentations, and I'll spare you the long bios on the back of your flyer. Everybody have a flyer? You can make notes on it. It's got the bios on the back. We'll start with Rob Buchanan, and then of the New York City Water Trail Association, You know, he's getting people on land and into water, and at so many places is the Water Trail Association and Village Community Boathouse and all the floating apple applets that have sprung up over the years. Amazing work. He'll talk about the Citizens Water Quality Testing Program, which our boathouse in Hoboken has been a participant in for a few years. Then we'll go to Dongping Wong of the Plus Pool, not just getting people on the water, but getting in the water. So it's an amazing initiative, and I'm so glad that, unlike many designers who run away from the regulators or just plow through them, been able and actively engaging with them to try to generate the data to show that not only does the project have merit, but there's data out there to support in-water and direct water use for recreation. We'll go to Rebecca McMackin from Brooklyn Bridge Park, who has started and created a consortium of coastal parks from the lessons from Sandy, learning about all these damaged landscapes from parks all across the region, and doing what the Alliance does best, which is getting people to talk to each other and work together and try to engage in joint problem solving. And then last, we'll have Justine Shapiro-Kline from WXY Architecture and Planning, who will talk about data and its use in planning and public policy as we kind of enter this era of larger scale resilience and coastal defense and community development in sort of an uncertain climate future. So for now, I'll turn it over to Rob.
Great.
So Carter already started my show. This is slide number two. I'm going to talk about the Water Trail Association is a group of human-powered boaters, and we're trying to look after the common interests of all the community boathouses in the harbor, and there are a lot of them now, depending on how you count. So that's who we are, and this is the person who started the Water Trail. She's the Queensboro Parks Commissioner, Dottie Lewandowski. And what's significant of this, the Water Trail was officially created by the Parks Department. It's a network of launch sites around the harbor. And what's important about it is it's the first time the city officially said, approved the idea of the citizenry getting into the water. So it was a really big step, and we should not forget that. That happened in 2008. And our first data project was the creation of a map, along with a group called Going Coastal and a really talented map maker named Jenya Slutskin. We made this map, and the blue dots indicate the legal places where you can launch. And we were really pleased with this, and we've got a lot of mileage out of this. And it was a great thing to stand up and unfold at a public meeting and to hand out to people. And it really went a long way towards explaining this idea that the harbor is a public waterway. It's open to all. Nobody owns it except us. But this happened in the summer of 2011. There was a major fire at the wastewater treatment plant in West Harlem. And we found out about it we had some boats out rowing that day down in the village almost 10 miles away and smelled something really, really wrong and realized that there were some water quality issues. This is why we got interested. What happened, the plant was taken offline and the sewage that would normally flow to it was diverted into the harbor. It was the hottest weekend of the summer and there was a kind of a panicked reaction, and the result was that essentially the harbor became off limits for the next few days for boating, and nobody at the city or anywhere could say what is actually going on in the water, what is the water quality. So I'm not going to go through CSOs, but this is obviously the top pollution issue, sewage in the harbor, when it rains or when there's an event like a fire, it flows into water. And if you go to the city has great data, but it's displayed in a way that is really difficult to interpret for the layperson. And this is the kind of thing you would encounter. It's all there, tons of data, including one column that describes bacteria, which is the thing we're interested in, but it's hard to decode and figure out where the sites were, what the dates were. The data isn't posted frequently. It's posted about every few weeks, but you have to wait a long time to figure out what the water quality was because they need to do quality assurance. So, and then these are the sites where the city tests something called the Harbor Survey, and they've tested for 100 years. So fantastic data, not accessible. And we thought, can we do better? Can we figure out, can we, first of all, can we find what the water quality is where we're using the water, and can we convey it in a way that's easier to understand? And I don't really want to go through all of this, but we're basically testing for sewage the same way that the city tests for sewage at the bathing beaches. And that means looking for this particular kind of bacteria, which is considered the best indicator of sewage in the water. And we're focusing on nearshore testing locations instead of the mid-channel locations that the city is often testing at. And just one thing that everybody needs to understand about testing for bacteria is that you can't do it in real time. You have to incubate your sample for a day before you know. So there's no such thing as going down to the launch site, sticking a probe in the water and saying, oh, there's a lot of sewage here. You can't know that for a day. There are lots of new technologies that might change, probably will change in our lifetime, but for now, this is the most practical way to do it. Okay, so we found out about a kit that's very easy to for citizen groups like ours to use. We got a great partner, the River Project, with a small lab, and these are River Project interns and lab techs. And this is the way that you get the results when this particular system called IDEX Quantitray. And the illuminated cells give you an indication of how dirty the water is. So these samples here, extremely dirty water, and those samples on the far left are much cleaner. And you can calculate the exact, well not the exact, but the most probable number of bacteria per 100 milliliters and determine then what the water quality is. So we created an interface. We didn't hire anybody, we just did it with Google Maps. And if you click on each of those icons, those are our testing sites. Here's kind of a close-up. So these are all the places in this lower East River section where we test. And if you click further, it takes you to this sort of a photo of the particular site, and then you can click on the link to the spreadsheet. And so this is how we indicate, this is how we convey our data about our testing sites. We have about 40 of these sites. You can click on any of them or the one that's nearest to your house. And what the green and the yellow and the red mean, they're the same system that the city uses at Coney Island or at any of the bathing beaches. And what that means is that green meets the standards for bathing, yellow is a sort of an advisory middle ground, and red fails the standards for swimming. So we're boaters. But nevertheless, this gives a pretty good idea of what water quality is like. And this particular site is Inwood Canoe Club, and this is 2015 results. Weekly tests at Inwood Canoe Club, which is way up on Dykeman Street in Inwood. And pretty good. They only failed two outright, and they had a couple of advisory days there. This is the Gowanus Canal last year. We didn't quite get 20 tests. We missed 1 week, but you can see a much different level. And I want you to try and also what's going on over here is rainfall. Because of the relationship between rainfall and sewage overflows in the harbor, we tried to chart the rain so that we could see if there was a correlation, which obviously there is. But I want you to remember that slide just because I'm going to come back to it right at the end in about 3 minutes. Here's another way of conveying our data. Also, Google spreadsheets, homemade. No tech people, no money spent. Our whole budget is entirely about testing supplies. That's all we spend money on. But this is a week by week. And you can see that there was a lot of rain here, but it was 3 days before we tested. That was a good week, very good week. And the bad weeks are where there's significant rain right before we test. And these are, you know, the worst week of the whole season last year was the last week. And we had failure at almost every place, but it rained an inch and a quarter the day before we tested. So it's just another way of understanding. I think it's a much clearer and better way of quickly understanding the relationship between rainfall and water quality in the harbor than spreadsheets that you can't interpret without a lot of work. Okay, and then just quickly, I think you can see the testing site for the DEP is kind of out in the channel. Our site is on the beaches of Stuyvesant Cove, East 20th Street. And we plotted our results. Our results are in red here. And our numbers are typically higher than the DEP's numbers. And the same thing, here's another comparison mid-channel, West Harlem. Again, our numbers over the course of the season are higher than the DEPs. That's, you know, they're out in the middle of the channel. They're getting a better tidal flushing. And Helen's Cove is a really interesting site that's down here where we test. There is no DEP test site near there. They test around here in Hellgate, and we compared that. And once again, our numbers are significantly higher. So, how does this data get used? I think we were partially responsible for an investigation that happened at Howard's Cove because the numbers were so high, whether it rained or not. And there was a discovery of a NYCHA house that was not connected to the sewer and was instead draining into the cove. We don't yet know. They fixed that, supposedly. But we haven't got enough data to know whether it's made a difference. But we should, by the end of this year, have an understanding of, I think, we'll have a much better understanding whether that really worked. So does citizen data work? I think it helped persuade the city to do an investigation and led at least indirectly to this discovery. So I want to take some credit for that anyway. And another thing I think that we had a hand in is the Sewage Pollution Right to Know Act, which means that wastewater treatment facilities must advertise their overflows when they happen. That's a change, and the state finally passed that law a couple of years ago. I think we had a hand in that. Okay, so just to wrap up, where do we want to go with this? We want to make our database better. Right now, we're using rainfall figures from Central Park, but you know what happens in Central Park doesn't really have anything to do with the airports and the other side of town. So if we could get local rainfall data, that would be great. We want the DEP to monitor closer to the shore, to change and expand their monitoring, and we also want them to do something like what we do in terms of displaying their data. They could do that easily. In fact, we could do it for them. But they can present their data in a way that's really understandable. And the last thing we want to do, the city is now in the midst of preparing what's called long-term control plans. It's a plan for addressing the CSO issue. And we want to use our data, and you saw some of the data, our results seem to be higher in a lot of places, to persuade them that the city needs to do more to fix this or to start to address this CSO problem. So those are our goals. And let me just give you one specific, and I'll end with this, but this is the cover of the draft plan for the Gowanus long-term control plan. And when you actually read it, what you find and what the fine print actually says, well, first of all, the data that they're basing this long-term control plan on is actually pretty skimpy. It's only from a few months, 1 year. I don't think it's enough. I think we have collected more data than they're using to base this long-term control plan on. And you also find that they are claiming here, down here, this is very technical, but basically what they're claiming is that the geometric mean, the average score of their water tests in the Gowanus are at 30 CFU for Enterococcus, which means green. So they're claiming that the average water quality result in the Gowanus that they're basing this long-term control plan on is all systems go to swimmable water on average. And just remember that slide I showed you, all the red results in the Gowanus. It cannot be both things. I don't think we're wrong, but I think they need to do more work if this is how they want to proceed. And I really think that our data is going to be effective in making them work harder on all of these long-term control plans. That's it. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dong. I'm going to talk about a project called Plus Pool. And I first wanted to say I'm actually very proud to follow Rob. One, because he's been very generous with his boathouse and actually allowing us to do some of the tests over Pier 40, but also I think the work that the trail does has really basically allowed us to do our work. So it's sort of just very nice to physically actually literally follow his presentation with ours. So Plus Pool, just a quick intro to it, it's an initiative started by four friends, including myself, now almost actually 6 years ago. And it was just the idea that could you put an Olympic-sized plus-shaped pool into the river that filtered river through the walls of the pool. So what that means on a kind of average day, it actually filters upwards of 600,000 gallons of river water with the idea that people get a chance to kind of swim in real river. And then that water also gets filtered again because people are pretty dirty. as it returns back into the river. So obviously, I mean, it's literally nothing compared to the volume of the river, but it is in a very tiny, or at least psychological way, filtering the river, and we like to kind of think of it that way. But what the kind of design side of it is that in the walls of the pool, we're working on the filtration system. It's basically thought of as a giant strainer, like a big wall full of Britas, basically, that you can drop into the river. The original idea, which is actually in concept anyway similar, is that it's a layering of different materials, some from wastewater treatment, some from drinking water, so that each layer does just a very limited amount of filtration, kind of takes out smaller and smaller contaminants. And the impetus for the project, to be quite honest, was I think twofold. One was being really sweaty in New York in the summer. And I'm from San Diego. I grew up surfing and on the beach and stuff, but actually right now I live closer to real water than I ever have in my entire life. But it doesn't really feel that way. I certainly don't go swimming in the river every day. And the second was, after being here for a while, just you realize that people like Rob have known this for a long time, that it's water. It's not just a border between Brooklyn and Manhattan. It's actually real, it's a natural resource, it's actually something quite incredible. So was there a way that you could kind of get people back into it or appreciate it or touch it in some way? And that was really the idea, is even if people are not necessarily environmentally conscious, if they don't really care about what it's doing, maybe for the first time they feel comfortable sort of jumping in the river. So we started testing the filtration. This is in 2011 at Brooklyn Bridge Park. We brought out a test tank. What the tank did was it brought river water up into the tank and then back out. This is before it got filtered, in case you're wondering. And each of those screens, or each of those kind of sections, had a different screen of materials. We're just testing different combinations. We did a similar thing in 2014, and this is what all the data that I'll get into in a minute came from, where we built in river version, kind of duct tape science lab version of the filtration system. Each of these pools basically had different frames that we could load in and out, trying different materials. We sailed it from Jersey on a kind of cold day and sat on it or held it out for about 4 months out in front of Rob's boathouse on Pier 40. This is with one tub kind of active at the moment, and we filled up all three and tried different combinations. None of us had any experience with water quality, with water, let alone building a pool or anything that floated before this. I'm trained as an architect, but literally, if you told me to build something in water, I had no idea how to do it up until a few years ago. So we've been working with Arup, a big engineering firm, and Lamont Doherty up at Columbia, who literally posted things on the wall there that gave us step-by-step guides on how to test all this water. What's funny is when Rob showed the slide of this IDEX stuff, I didn't think it'd ever be in a presentation where IDEX would show up twice, but same thing. So we do the same kind of bacteria testing, actually also with River Project, who are amazing. And we test about 15 different parameters. So as Rob said, the bacteria one is a very manual test. It's about a 24-hour turnaround. But for a lot of these other parameters, we use something called a YSI, which is basically, it looks like a 3-foot-long PVC tube kind of thing that you drop into the river, and it actually just live reads a lot of parameters and uploads it every 15 minutes. And so we test quite a bit. What we ended up realizing is, just because we were concerned down the road with when you jump into the water feeling you know exactly what the water is doing at any given point, we test bacteria every day, but we test everything else, like I said, every 15 minutes. So we were gathering such a kind of immense amount of data that we didn't really know what to do about it. This is actually one of the data points we gathered over at Pier 40, so obviously it looks like a mess. But really what this is, at the top you see the different combos. What we were doing at Pier 40 was actually trying different material combinations. What you'll see is the red is what the river does bacterially, so it jumps up and down a lot. You can obviously see in the beginning our pool wasn't doing a whole lot, it was basically following that same thing. But the last couple combos is more important, because what we were able to achieve was, no matter what the river ended up doing, we were able to zero out all the bacteria coming in. So this blue line at the bottom, which looks fake, frankly, in the test and the graph, is basically the bacteria level of the pool. And so our goal, which we're able to achieve at Pier 40, which was incredibly exciting, kind of in real conditions, was dropping at least to pool standard, if not even cleaner. We're trying to do all of this without chemicals, basically find ways. And this is where the regulatory issue comes in, because there is no pool without chlorine technically at the moment. So we're working with everybody basically to see if there's a way to change that. What was fun for us anyway is that we got to jump for the first time in so-called plus pool water, the very ugly version of our pool. But I think in a lot of ways, the reason we wanted to do it was, I think just as people that live in New York, we wanted to see if there's a way that we could contribute toward making the city better. And so what literally started as a kind of sketch idea is now, this summer, we've been, this is an image obviously of Brooklyn Bridge Park, actually surprisingly fitting, I think, to lead into the next, into Rebecca's presentation. But we've been working since last summer to narrow down the site that the pool will go to. So we're shortlisted to four at the moment. And if all goes well, we'll make an announcement this summer about how home will be. And then the goal by the end of the year to really get towards permit-ready drawing. So we're about, if all goes well, the pool should be in the water by 2020, summer 2020. At least that's our kind of target. But I think we're just sort of very, it's something as a bonus to the project which we never expected is the fact that we're kind of part of these conversations now, these conversations about how to engage people in the waterfront, all the science and the data behind it, which I don't think we ever thought we'd be a part of when we started it. So yeah, thank you.
Evening, everyone. That was our park, and this is also our park. This is during Hurricane Sandy. And that is our carousel right there. And the land line is right about there. And the water goes way into up the land. This is a close-up. This is the carousel. It's under about 3 feet of water, as was much of the park during Hurricane Sandy. And so I'm the director of horticulture at the park, so I care about anything that's not hardscape, essentially, in the park. This is our park. There's quite a bit of it which is not hardscape, and quite a bit of it which is right at the water level. Obviously, we're built on reclaimed shipping piers. The park was designed by MVVA, and it averages about 9 feet above sea level. So it's really, really close to the water. And was very much underwater during Hurricane Sandy. This is from right down the street here. This is from Battery Park City. They had catastrophic levels of damage from Hurricane Sandy, as did many of the regional parks and landscapes in the area, because they had large trees and very traditional bulkhead designs, which we did not. Because our park is so new, this was the one tree that we lost during Hurricane Sandy. Our trees are just really small and bendy. And also many of our planted areas were designed to be coastally appropriate. So this is a coastal shrub mix in front of a salt marsh. So these are both ecologies that are very happy to live in areas that have flooding occasionally. This is a meadow that closely mimics the Hempstead Plains, so it's perfectly fine with salt. And this is a bioswale that was designed to withstand occasional flooding as well. So much of the park was perfectly fine. MVVA also created these soft edges to the park, and these edges along with the salt marshes were very helpful in attenuating wave action. So the damage to the infrastructure of the park also wasn't as great as many other areas saw. And in the days and weeks after Hurricane Sandy, we started seeing a lot of damage that made a lot of sense. We saw a lot of salt damage. You can see the water line really clearly in these shrubs. Anything that was submerged died. Anything that was above it survived. And then we saw a lot of things that didn't make any sense at all. And as you can imagine, those of us who are landscape managers were running around trying to save all of our trees and save all of our plants, and we had no idea what to do. So we're running around trying to save everything while at the same time doing an incredible amount of research trying to figure out what to do. And so we're all on the phone to each other trying to, you know, say, what are you doing? Are you flushing with water? Are you trying to save plants from being drowned? Is it, which is the enemy? Is it the water? Is it salt? Everybody's trying to figure everything out, and what became readily apparent is that there's no body of work. There's no literature on this. There's no information on this for people to refer to in these kinds of situations, which everybody seems to think are going to happen more and more over time. So I started tracking plant response, and I encouraged all of the various landscapes that I was in contact with to do the same thing. And then I sent out a formal request for everybody who I knew who would have that same level of information or might be interested. And we started a group called the Consortium of Coastal Parks. And we're a group of about 15 parks and gardens and public landscapes who meet quarterly, and we do a few things. Our first goal is, of course, to share information to better manage our landscapes. We also were able to develop and disseminate a best management practices document for both for before, during, and after storm events. It's just a one pager that we email out to everybody we know when there's a possibility of a storm event. We have published a bibliography of helpful research. It was really hard information to find. We want to make it easy to find. But the real bulk of the work that we do is tracking plant response to flooding, specifically. And, you know, also one of the main reasons why we formed this group is that we wanted to take something really awful that happened and turn it into something very useful for everybody to try and find what we could learn from this situation. And it's important for public landscapes, it's important for parks, specifically because when you look at the flood maps for the 100-year flood plan and on into the future, it maps very closely onto the park maps of New York City. So we are very much affected landscapes, and we'll be dealing with this over and over and over again. So this is, what did we end up doing? This is our BMP document that we came out with. I'd hoped to bring some that didn't work out, but if you want a copy of it, I'm really happy to send them around. And this is available. And then this is the data that we collected, me and my team collected at Brooklyn Birch Park. You can see that we just tracked each plant. And then we created a color-coded system for looking at how it survived over time, and then we kept on checking in on these plants every few months, and this changed over time. But then when we tried to synthesize that data with other parks, we ran into some issues. So it's both very good and slightly difficult that these plants are in so many different situations. So it's wonderful from a data collection perspective because you get this same plant in a wide variety of different situations, different soils, different levels of resources that are available. Some parks were able to irrigate as much as they wanted and hire water trucks. Other parks had no gardening staff, and it was essentially survival of the fittest. So that's really good information in one level because you can see how plants perform in different scenarios, but it's also difficult because it made it really hard to find patterns. And so we had these lists of, it was almost 1,000 plants between all of the groups who were involved. And then we went through and we tried to find patterns, and we worked with Nina Basick at Cornell, and she helped us organize the data. And we were able to pull out about, depending on how robust that data is, we were able to find between 200 and 300 plants that we were able to say, these are coastally appropriate, these are absolutely inappropriate in this context, and find consistent patterns throughout. So we found things like that these two native magnolias did just fine in the flood, this exotic magnolia did not. This one common street tree, the pin oak, was perfectly fine. This other very common street tree, the London plane tree, died all throughout the city. So this is information that's really, really valuable to people who manage and design landscapes. And normally, everybody in the audience clamors to try and get this list of plants, and I'm very sad to say that we haven't been able to publish it yet. So that's really our next step, is looking at ways to publish that information and then really disseminate it to the groups who really need it, which we haven't figured out quite yet. But one, I don't think that this is really the group for plant information, but one thing that I thought you might find interesting is that the overarching factor for how well plants did was soil compaction, more than anything else. It was about soil compaction. You can see this is a chart that we did looking at how quickly salinity levels dropped in the soil. And you can see this yellow here is the safe salinity level. And so it dropped very quickly over time. This one area was incredibly compacted. And you can see when the soils are compacted, the water's not flowing through. And so any plants in that situation have a much more difficult time. So really, you know, the best thing that you can do to make your landscape more resilient in the face of flooding is to fence the landscape to keep it from being compacted. So this is my favorite design feature in our entire park. It's a range fence that MBVA designed that it really still allows the landscape to be accessible. Both sides of the path here have 4-foot high fences, and it keeps the plants healthy, keeps the soil healthy, and that's one of the main reasons why our plants did so much better than plants in other parks, was because the soils were able to drain. And we used that information on a very practical level. We used it to replant the areas that did get damaged during Hurricane Sandy, from the herbaceous material, the ground layer, all the way up to the trees. We ended up losing over time about 100 trees just from the salt and the water damage, and we replanted with trees that would be okay to deal with another flood in the future. And we continue testing. Now we don't plant new plants unless we go out and dunk them into the river. And even older plants, it's trial by fire. And yeah, that's really it. Thank you.
Change gears slightly, stepping back a little bit from the water's edge. The work I'm going to speak about is a project we worked on over the course of 2015 as part of a large multidisciplinary engineering team where we at WXY were the planners. It was a project that was looking at storm surge barriers and upland defenses for Newtown Creek and Gowanus Canal. So we were not looking at the water quality so much as the flood protection on the other side. The study came out of the city's SIRR report, which even though it wasn't advocating storm surge barriers as a general strategy for climate adaptation, did think that in certain cases with smaller waterways, these systems could protect neighborhoods on either side of the waterways from flooding. And the two principal goals were, in each case, to identify a resilient strategy for flood protection for the waterway and that would have benefits to adjacent communities, and then also to tee up the work to lead into Army Corps and city further planning and future study. So the piece of the work that I'm going to talk about today was a community engagement platform or stakeholder engagement platform that we developed to use with city agencies, elected officials, and the general public. And we ended up using it with city agencies. So there's a lot to talk about future applications for this software. And we were really concerned with communicating two things. First, the physical conditions for each of these two study areas in a way that was readily understandable for a whole range of people. And second, to make it accessible for stakeholders to see the costs, benefits, and planning impacts associated with any flood defense system. So, we collaborated on this project with a software company in the Netherlands called Tigrin, and their engine, as they call it, is something a little bit similar to a gaming engine. And it pulls in all sorts of publicly available data from New York City, including terrain, elevation data, building footprints, combined with roadways, and also Pluto data. Which allows them to, for us to decide an area that we're going to create a game out of, or planning exercise, and to read in all of that information. So you have things like how many square feet a building has, and what its use is, and who the owner is, and what the ground elevation is. So those are some of the pieces of information that you can see here just by mousing over a warehouse. And in addition to that, we were able to code certain things in terms of like the mouth of Newtown Creek, where there are development sites, or which land use is specific to whether it was city-owned property or private property. So now I'm just going to walk you through the platform and the different aspects of it. Basically, what we created was a map of the city that's a 3D visualization just for this area around the mouth of the creek, where we were anticipating stakeholders being able to test and evaluate and compare different storm surge barrier systems, and the same for the Gowanus Canal. And so we brought together the data that was publicly available with certain overlays that we created as a team, so that we could add some of the research that we'd done over the course of the study. So for example, this is showing property ownership, and in the previous slide, this shows the 17-foot contour, which was for our study, the design flood elevation, and the height that we were designing to. And then back here, we have land use. So we included those kinds of pieces of information that you can see on this one. On the one hand, you have the kind of plan view, and then on the other, you can zoom in and really see how the contour lines up with individual blocks or properties. And we also brought into that an overlay that shows all of the different options that we came up with as a team. You could see them relative to each other. And the navigation routes, so that you could understand how a barrier might affect what the current accessibility of the waterway is for vessels. The next thing, and these are all screenshots, it would be more fun if we could do this dynamically. This is something we spent a lot of time working on over the course of the year, figuring out a way to dynamically simulate flooding. So, of course, the name of the game is to prevent flooding in the neighborhoods adjacent to the waterway. And what we wanted to test out with this and to visualize was by clicking a button to see how, in this case, the 500-year flood covers the neighborhood. The next piece of that is to test out both the concept options that we came up with as a team, and then also for stakeholders to be able to test their own ideas freehand and sort of compare them in real time. And so the two pieces of that are important are, one, understanding where things are going physically and what the dimensions are, whether the team is proposing a levee or a flood wall, and of course we're working with a kind of limited toolbox of options. And the second piece of that is understanding what's protected. And so this, what we call the indicators, which are across the top, were a series of measurements that were based on unit types and different land uses, which enable the user of the game to draw in flood protection and then see how many residents are protected or how many jobs are protected, or since these two waterways are heavily industrial on both sides, how many industrial square feet of lot area or of built area were protected. And so here in the red, you're seeing what was naturally high ground. It's kind of the inverse of the flood map that we just saw a couple slides ago. And then in orange, so along here, what you're not seeing too clearly, little bit of a flood, the flood barrier is there, and then the protection would be theoretically coming along the shoreline. You're seeing all of the area of green point that would theoretically be protected with this system. And then at the top, you see in real time, you know, what percent of the, and it's a little bit limited because we have a certain map area, but what percent of the residents in this square of map area, which is the same as this one, are protected. So then further step is you can click open any of these indicators and get a sense of what the total industrial floor area is and what's now in the protected area. And so this allows stakeholders to test out what the team is proposing and then try their hand at alternatives and see how that works out. So just to wrap up, we did not get to test this and bring it to communities in either of the areas, which is a bit of a challenge for us as planners and designers. But it was a great tool to get onto the ground a little bit more and to make both of the study areas more accessible to city agencies who were trying to understand what they were planning for and how they were planning. And what it really allows is for stakeholders to bring their own perspectives and their own experiences and to the table and test that out in a variety of different ways. Thanks.
So if people can crunch their own data for just a couple seconds, I want to do the quick obligatory thanks to the panel for the great imagery. Hope an MWA will make it available, and that the panelists are okay with that. Because by golly, we're in like this open society. We should be sharing more. And that's one thing I appreciate more about working with the Dutch, is with their data that they collect publicly or even privately. They do a much better job of making it accessible to the public than I often feel sometimes here in the United States that we do. We should be transparent as much as possible with the data we have or the data we need. Can I get a quick show of hands of people who actually in some way collect their own data related to their work or advocacy? Who's involved in the data world? So really like, I'd say less than 10%. Is that fair? So not a huge number. But we can improve upon that. A couple questions that we want to throw out to the panels, and I think as you go along through the survey, some potential questions will pop up. Is that happening now already? Oh, it happens at the end. Okay, good. Has anybody having technical problems that they want to try to figure out? I used to laugh at this. In 2002, I thought it was weird. And it was, I think it was 2002, it was a year after 9/11, and there was a huge event at the Javits Center called Listening to the City. Anybody ever heard or remember Listening to the City? Anybody participate in that? I mean, it was like 5,000 people in the Javits Center trying to, with a little bit of real-time data, kind of take our quote-unquote social values and kind of translate them to planning goals and parameters so that the quote-unquote powers that be could understand what the public wanted to see with the future of the World Trade Center site. The woman who ran the whole thing, the group was called America Speaks, and it was awkward at first, but then you realize, like, wow, this is really amazing, and this is where, you know, now that we've got the designers collecting data, by golly, the policymakers are going to have to catch up. Anyway, thank you all again for your presentation. I'll throw out a first question unless you've got something that pops up on the screen that you feel like is compelling.
You want me to do that?
Yeah. All right, so we see a lot of paddlers. We see a lot of people involved in storm relief. Wow, that's encouraging. So, I mean, this bucket of issues is sort of, there's recreation and on-water activity, but there over to the right, you see it's all about stewardship. So it's really encouraging to see we've got waterfront and waterway stewards more than half in the mix here. And the votes keep going up. I don't want to get too far of everyone. I would say I'm going to throw it to Rob first because I feel like your water testing, I mean, it's really important. And I think in the conversations back to long-term control plans and others, there's the data that the public sector makes available to us. There's the data that they're required to collect. And it's not always the same thing. So I just wonder if in your long-term control plan advocacy, have you seen some good examples around the city where communities or long-term control plan projects are better organized or better directed? I don't know if you mentioned it, but there's something like 5 or 6 different long-term control plans all in process now. Can you talk a little bit about that?
I think there are more than that. I think it's 9 or 10. And it's basically organized by drainage. And yes, I think people have really gotten involved. So if you go to specific drainages, I mean, the most recent example is Flushing Creek and Flushing Bay, where people have really stepped up in the last year to start testing and pushing back. And so I think that long-term control plan will change as a result of that. And mm-hmm. I don't know how. It's great to see people get motivated. There's on the other end is the question of expense and cost benefit and weighing that. And I think that's a fair response for the agency is to say, well, this is great. We'd love to bring Flushing Creek into swimmable condition, but the price tag on that is $55 trillion. And so your utility rates would go through the, no, I'm making that price up, but I think that's a fair pushback too. And so, it's always gonna be a balancing thing, but that's one place that I'd point to first, probably. Bronx River, though, also, in a kind of slightly different way, has gotten very organized, maybe earlier. And I see it also in Yonkers, which is outside of the city, but I think that there is a similar movement building there. They've got this problem on the Sawmill River, mm-hmm. which they are struggling to understand. And so those are the places I point to.
Anybody involved in the long-term control planning process? LTCP? Wow, one person. Thank goodness you're here, because you can add a little more detail when we throw some of it back to the audience. But let me just say, as a planner whose industry has helped to create abbreviations and taken language and turned it into things that nobody understands, I would say that long-term control planning process is probably one of the most important public policy initiatives for the next 10, 20 years, because it's going to take water quality goals of what we'd like to see where, and the public agencies that manage and control our wastewater treatment infrastructure are going to, that's going to become their playbook. So if we don't get active in these conversations, those of us who are waterway users, and there's a lot of us, it's going to be a missed opportunity to try to take our public values, or our own personal values, our own social values, and embed them in the way we as society and government build. Let's take it to swimming, though, for a minute. Dong, you mentioned coming out of the design community and not being a data collection specialist along the way. Can you talk about how your work as a designer with the waterway users of swimmers and others, and maybe swimmers in particular, did you get to interact or experience, or in addition to the symbolic dip you enjoyed illegally off the south side of Pier 40, we're glad that you could join us here today and aren't in the Hudson River Park Just Jail, but can you talk about any of your interactions, positive or negative, with some of the waterway users?
The project, a bit of context, when we launched it, we basically just built a website and put the website up, and we're hoping people would see it and contact us, because we honestly had no idea how to build or get something like this off the ground. And literally the very first person that emailed us was an open water swimmer, and she's been doing the kind of swim around the city and the swim up and down the Hudson for years and years and years. And at first we actually thought she'd be really kind of against the project, because obviously there are times when you can swim without much of a problem, and there's a lot of open water swimming organizations. But she was really excited about it, just because she said, I don't really care how people swim in the water as long as more people swim. That's really what she cared about. And that was super encouraging. And the other thing she said was, we asked her if she swims all year round, and she says yes. And I asked her what kind of wetsuit she wears, and she says, oh, I only wear earplugs in the winter, because I'm a bit of a masochist. And I was like, holy shit, there are some crazy people in this world. And then from that point on, I basically realized that half the product, the fun of it is I feel like everybody we've met that works on the water or is part of the water is like they're at the edge of the city for a sort of a reason. Like they're always like weirder and more interesting than any other part of the city that we work with, and so that's really awesome.
Socially maladjusted.
It's kind of awesome. It's amazing.
Great perspective. Let me throw something at Rebecca, and then anyone else who wants to take a picture of the screen, I'm going to change it in a second. You know, you mentioned that as a horticulturalist, were trying to help the park recover, help bring the park back to normalcy for the benefit of everybody who lives around it and uses it, there was no body of work to help you. Who do you see as the potential users of a body of work like that?
Many, many people and organizations. I think that obviously there are other landscape managers in my same position who could find it useful, but really designers. People who are designing parks could absolutely, even just that one piece of information about fencing would change so many landscapes. And then the plant list, clearly. And also homeowners. So much of the information that is out there is geared towards homeowners and which hydrangea you can plant at your beach house in the Hamptons. It's a huge, huge industry there. It's a wonderful way to get people, again, more involved in their landscapes and thinking about the mobility of the water into the landscape as well.
Thank you. Justine, I want to throw one at you, and then after this screen, I think you all should turn around and take a peek at it, just so you get a chance to comment on it before we move on to the next one, and then move on to audience questions. The software that you showed, sort of the real world GIS with a third dimension, with a human dimension, with a lot of data behind it. I mean, one of the biggest changes we've all seen in the last 10 years is just how we visualize the built environment, whether it's a new building, whether it's a new park landscape, whether it's a shadow, whether it's a wind corridor. And when you look at the tool which WXY created, how do you feel, what needs to happen next in terms of making a tool like that more useful and accessible to the big green word in the middle, which is the public? How do you take a complicated set of data of all these measurables that may mean different things to different people, which we all maybe hold in a different hierarchy? How do you make them more meaningful and accessible to the public?
Well, I think our hope for the Tigrin platform and for this project moving forward would be to actually take the tool out and meet with community members in the two study areas. But also, one of the great things about what we developed was it's a game and it kind of serves as a template. So it's possible to take it and start with a different area of New York City and read in all the buildings and roadways in that area and bring it to a totally different audience. So I think for us, we'd really like feedback from the public and be able to refine it further. We started in a very specific place with just a few simple moves, with barriers and with upland defenses like levees and flood walls and riprap. And what I'd personally like to see is the range of things that we think about in relation to these flood barrier systems, and also the range of tools to become much broader. So we're not just asking, do you put a flood barrier here or do you put it there? But we're asking about, what are the other things we want in urban neighborhoods, and what are the trade-offs between those and flood defenses?
I mean, when I see the visualization, this is the second time I've seen it, so thank you again for presenting. I go back to 10 years ago when there was an initiative by the Sloan Foundation to use real-world GIS data in community board meetings, and it was an education and training program for local high school kids, and they were assigned to different community boards, the ones where they lived, and their job basically was to sit there at community board meetings and run Google Maps for the board, so that as they're talking about schools, as they're talking about new housing, as they're talking about new bars, people in the neighborhood could get beyond the anecdotal and get to the more kind of site-specific. Anybody involved in community board initiatives or policy or politics? Great. Is that kind of work still happening at the community board level, using real-world technology to kind of shape local land use information? Yes, ma'am, in the back.
Hi, so I'm an intern with the Manhattan Borough President's Office.
Mm-hmm.
And if there's anyone present from the community board that wants that to happen, I'd be glad to carry that message directly to the president and the community board's director, Lucille Songhai, tomorrow morning. And additionally, I'd like you to know that the land use policy person was here. We came to this meeting together, but he had to go to a Community Board 6 meeting to deliver maps.
Well, his absence early is excused. As long as you take that message back that by this big show of hands, more local data and community awareness and community level of education. Can I get one more hand besides mine? It's kind of lonely up here. Raising one hand is kind of lonely. It's like being a Bernie Sanders supporter or something. But it's for where we are in data and visualization, and for as much time and energy and process goes into community planning boards, $500,000 to $1 million in staff and effort spent to influence this kind of decision making. I firmly believe we need better tools. I'm going to move on from this slide on waterfront data, and I think some questions might come up. But you can see a lot of themes in here. I mean, and the public is front and center, but I think that whether that is citizens or whether that's government or whether that's elected, obviously there's a lot of overlap between between these organizations or between these individuals. I mean, the two that I added to it were electeds and the media, because I feel like the media is so important at amplifying people's message. They do a great job at amplifying the wrong message sometimes. So if we can help them amplify what we think are the right messages, that's good for everybody. And elected officials, you know, whether it's 2-year, 4-year, 6-year, or forever terms, it's really important to put these issues in front of them, especially with their influence over policy and policy and budget. So here's some of the open-ended questions that came in, or open-ended comments as to how data can help people, help all of us connect to the waterfront and waterways. Just take a minute to skim it. When I see that blue square down at the bottom, I want to go back to Don and just ask him, you know, to put the plus pool maybe in a numbers perspective. You know, the floating pool has been around for, I guess, almost a decade now. New York City pools and others, wonderfully popular for over 100 years. What would be the actual, what can the plus pool ultimately offer? Like, how many people could be in it at once, and how big would it be? A little bit more on the details.
Sure. So it's Olympic size pool, which just means it's 50 meters long. It's Olympic size pool, so it means it's 50 meters long in both directions. At full capacity, it would be, I think, just about 400 swimmers at a time. Kara may know this. Sorry, our deputy director, Kara. I mean, we were trying to figure out kind of summer-wide, depending on the typical turnaround, what a summer number was, and I'm completely blanking on that. Do you remember?
I think it was like 300,000.
Yeah, it sounds right. So basically, we're expecting around 300,000 people to be able to swim in it in the kind of 3 summer swimming months.
Mm-hmm. And with all the data you collected, and you talked about water or swimming pool quality or swimmable quality, did that translate into, for the filtration and other capacity that you provide, did that translate into net water quality benefits, even on a very local level?
You're saying with the actual, like, filtering of the water?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, if you measure the kind of water coming out directly. I mean, in my sort of sense is it's not really going to change the river water quality significantly by any means.
Mm-hmm.
But I think one of the reasons we want to do the project, what we hope is that it changes at least psychologically how people kind of understand the riverway.
Mm-hmm.
When we started it, you know, we'd obviously learned about this kind of long-term plan from the city, a kind of a 50-year plan to sort of slowly clean the river that my understanding was sort of started 50 years ago and has another 50 years to go kind of thing. So our sense was there a way just from a citizen point of view to kind of just, again, change how you think about the water? So.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, literally cleaning the river, I don't think, unless you had 100 of our pools, you wouldn't make a huge dent.
But just by using real river water, I mean, to me, that gets a number of regulatory authorities and agencies, like, there's a eureka moment that happened
right
along the way when you turn the conversation to show that it's actually possible.
Right, and that's been a really interesting conversation. I mean, with almost every city and state regulatory agency that we talked to and we've talked to for the last 3 or 4 years is there's always that moment where their job goes from regulating what you're doing into a personal interest. Like, they literally change from going, this is gonna be a really difficult, hard thing to do, but on a personal level, if you could do it, it'd be amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And this is who you should talk to, and have you looked into this, and then that conversation gets really productive. But
mm-hmm.
I think we've learned to sort of just wait until that moment happens in meetings, basically.
And it usually does. And you're getting
well
there. I want to go on to the communication and collaboration and jump over Rob to go to Rebecca, because I feel like for complex issues such as anything related to water, ambient water, open water, water use, collaboration is really tough. I mean, I think it's key, but I also think it's tough. So can you talk about maybe some of your successes and some of your challenges at basically shepherding a really banner network of parks and park stewardship and agency groups together to help do the work that you did?
Sure. I mean, I think that I mean, the successes, hopefully we had many successes in that we've been able to get as far as we have so far. The data that we've been able to produce is very, very useful stuff if it can get into the hands of the people who actually need it. But the problems really at this point is that everybody has a full-time job. Nobody, this is not a nonprofit. This isn't a group with abundant resources. So to get to that next level where we actually do get the information into the hands of the people who would be able to use it most, that's a huge struggle that we haven't really figured out how to overcome yet. And we're still trying to explore new strategies for that. But I think just, it's wonderful to work with a group of interested people. And I think everybody was really thrilled to be able to find the usefulness in watching our landscapes die in certain ways, to be able to see this as something productive rather than something that was essentially very tragic. So everyone was really enthusiastic. Probably the hardest thing about collaborating is that everybody's a gardener, and gardeners are our quirky edge of the city folks, and it's very much like herding cats. But and then trying to jam those types of brains into Excel spreadsheets was also difficult, but that was where Cornell was really useful. So we had an umbrella of people who were more sciencey who were able to help us with that as well.
Very good. Yeah, I want to go back to Justine for a second, just on this, the bottom half of this page. You know, we talk the comment over on the right about fluctuating quantities in the river, basic quantities, and the tool you showed, which actually helps to measure, you know, the land use productivity, the residents who are protected, the jobs that are protected by moving a barrier. I mean, we've all seen pictures of Governor Rockefeller, you know, pointing at the Battery Park City model. You know, we've been in meetings where somebody draws a big line from, you know, the tip of Sandy Hook to the tip of the Rockaway Peninsula and says, yeah, we can protect this. But for the exercises or workshops or study that you did on Newtown Creek and the Gowanus Canal, were there any sort of surprises, either positive or negative, as the team and the stakeholders of agencies and design professionals, as you move the line from one place to the next, were there any lights going on or OMGs being uttered?
Well, not so much in where you put the line of defense, of flood defense, because particularly for Newtown, you always end up back at the water's edge to protect the largest population of residents. But I think maybe a big learning moment for the city agencies who are working with us was that there's an opportunity when they rezone parts of the city or when developments get a green light to go ahead to build those developments at higher elevations. Because particularly in Greenpoint, there are thousands of units that are either under construction or soon to be going into construction, and a waterfront esplanade that's being built by those developers and will eventually become part of the Parks Department, part of their property, you know, 20 years down the road. And in a location like that, there's a huge opportunity to raise the elevation of the edge all the way along a neighborhood by collaborating early and by thinking through how resiliency can be built into the urban fabric in a more human way.
Very good example. It's Greenpoint and Williamsburg for the largest waterfront rezoning in 50 years in the city. There's so many case studies from Domino Sugar all the way up to Newtown Creek. We have a few more minutes left, but I think in addition to the exercises in phraseology that are on the screen in front of you, we should turn it over to the Judiths and others in the audience who have questions or comments. Judith.
I reacted with great shock when you said there was no information. Maybe there's no information about New York City parks, but we have been having hurricanes on the Atlantic coast and flooding since before people ever lived here. And I'm an estuarine biologist, and I would eat my hat if estuarine biologists and coastal marine scientists have not got a body of data on which plants are more tolerant of salt water and which ones are not. I can't believe that.
Did you dig deep enough, she asked.
I dig so deep. I dug so deep. The information that is available are lists of coastally appropriate native plants. That information is abundant. There are books on that. And it's the same list over and over and over. And designers and homeowners are very rarely satisfied with that list, and park designers as well. So
maybe they ought to focus on that.
Our park is certainly dominated by those plants, and they, by and large, did really well, especially when soils were non-compacted. But the plants that make up most of our city aren't on that list. And certainly the city parks and coastal parks as well. And we did find, I think, you know, some of the most interesting information we found were which delicate garden-y plants were perfectly adapted, like hosta and dicentra, bleeding heart. Those are plants that did just fine with being underwater for 3 hours. And then plenty of native plants that are not typically thought to be coastal, like redbud is a tree that's it's an understory forest tree, and that was perfectly fine as well during Hurricane Sandy. So there is that list, certainly, of coastally adapted plant material, but once you get beyond, and it's a really limited, it is a very, very short list, so we were looking to expand that list. And beyond the plant list, you know, the information we were looking for, as much as landscapes have been flooded over and over and over, what to do when that flooding happens is anybody's guess. That information is not out there at all. And as I alluded to, some plants are perfectly fine with salt, some plants are perfectly fine with water, but those are completely different scenarios. And some plants, it was really interesting to try and discover why plants died. And so, that information is just not available.
I'm not familiar with this predictive database you mentioned. If it's predictive, is it releasing forecasts for future water quality? What is the predictive portion?
Yeah, well, so by predictive database, what I mean is there's no way to know. Like I was saying, you can't go down to the water you're going to launch or swim. You can't stick something in the water that tells you what the bacteria count is. But if you could have a database that was long-term enough and had enough data points and was really correlated to local rainfall in spots, then you could start to get a really good idea. It hasn't rained for 3 days. I mean, pretty much that's a green light in most parts of the harbor right now. But you could predict, you could start to predict fairly accurately whether or not you were going to encounter bacteria, and you could confirm that by testing the same day, but you wouldn't know for another day. So that's what I mean by, it's just a way, a user's guide to be a likely sort of best choice.
So it doesn't exist in any form currently. I was a little confused on that. There's no current version of this predictive database. It would be a thing we could do with more data like this.
With more data that would be accessible easily, we could, in fact, that's what you would arrive at.
And to add to Rob's answer, one of the big reasons we tested, we were looking at 15 other parameters, or 14 other parameters besides bacteria, was to try to find trends. Rainwater is literally the best one, obviously, but was turbidity kind of trending whenever you saw bacteria rise? Were there other ways you could kind of get a red flag and expect bacteria to be there when you tested it and got the result in 24 hours? Recently, we've been actually hearing that there is a bacteria test that's DNA-based that's 2 hours, but we haven't actually used it yet. One of the problems is it's not, or it's, I think, going through the process of becoming EPA approved, but I don't think it is quite yet, but I feel like that would actually be quite interesting.
Yeah.
And a question, gentleman who is to your left in the blue shirt. Yes, sir. Yeah.
I hate to raise this, but
go ahead.
Talking about that, since I'm wearing a suit, what seems to be missing here on this discussion is water transportation user community, which I'm not part of, but I'm quite aware of its impact on this city and in New Jersey, where I live, and the growth of cargo and the growth of demand for waterfront industrial and commercial uses. And our attempt to balance the public demand for water quality and safety, and I'm a sailor, and I have a sailboat in Liberty Landing Marina, and I'm a captain, but I also recognize the driver creates that opportunity. And unfortunately, that is that stinky waterfront industrial use.
Is it the port? Is it the port, or is it
to that balance?
So I just want to drill down your question a little more. Is it the ferries? Is it global commerce and container ships?
Is it watering, deballasting, increase in cargo movement, increase in one of the fights that I had to win, unfortunately, was to keep the Red Book container terminal. And had impact on the park and everything else. But the city had to recognize that the container terminal was vital for Red Hook, Brooklyn's economy. And so those are difficult issues that you've got to get those guys in this room too, to get their opinion, the captains, the tug drivers, everybody, the consignment shippers, all those people that make money on the water, they're the public too.
No, absolutely, and what I like about the pool and what I like about the water trail and others is that as we talk about in-water recreation, sailing, swimming, etc., a lot of that is not waterfront land use dependent. It's just periodic use along the channel, across the channel, in the near shore areas where the potential for conflict between heavy marine transport and local community recreation is kind of minimal. Most of these activities don't often cross, and as somebody, my boat's in the service area on land waiting to go in the water down by your pier. I think that awareness is actually a great success story of the Waterfront Alliance over the last 15 years, that more people get it, that the balance need, that people need to understand each other's perspective.
Well, for example, the coalition, you've got to get Liberty State Park in that group.
So bring Governor Christie to an MWA event if he's not busy being a lapdog to Donald Trump, and maybe he'll get some Eureka juice. Jose reminds me that a focus of one of these upcoming programs, I guess April 27th, will be on the marine sector. So that's part of the conversation. Rob, you got to do your shill for the harbor tour coming up in a couple weeks. Can you talk about that?
There is a captains and paddlers type event where we're trying to get commercial and recreational mariners together on one boat and to travel around the harbor and talk about issues from both sides. And we did that a few years ago. It was very successful, and we're going to try and do that again. But I just want to say, I mean, since we're talking about data tonight, I completely agree that we need to be much more aware of the commercial side of the economy and how important that is. But there's a lot of data still to be gathered on all sides of this issue. What is the value of clean water? We don't know, because there's many, many ways of measuring that. And, you know, we had 58 or 60 million tourists in New York City last year. That number just keeps going up. There's definitely a connection there. You know, lifestyle, tech companies moving here, people wanting to live here because of the lifestyle, that also has an economic value. And then there's all the habitat restoration of the fisheries and the long-term value of that. We have not ever really seriously tried to put value on a healthy estuary. So there's infinite work for everybody who wants to be in this measuring data business. You just got to figure out what your little niche is and go after it.
Other questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
Question for Rob. I'm not surprised that the heavy rainfall brought on a lot of rectangles on your chart. But I was wondering if you took into account in your scheduled sampling times, if you took into account the tide and the depth to the Picnicline.
The tide, and what was the second part of that?
The depth of the Picnicline.
Of the
which is where the salinity changes from the incoming ocean water.
Right. No, we didn't, because we're testing in 45 sites in all different parts of the harbor, and each of those sites has a different tidal situation, different tide time. And so the way that we left this as an open problem for specific users to solve, which is, how does the tide behave at my site? So we do post all the tide times, but we don't try to go any deeper in terms of which way the current is running, or you know, wind is another big factor here, because it's going to be pushing you know, different kinds of water into your test zone. So it's too much for an all-volunteer citizen science group to take on, but it's really interesting, and I you know, more data there, but we can't deal with that.
more and more technical partners. It's all about collaboration. I'm going to leave it here. We have another little bit in this space to socialize the question. I want everybody to take with them to the potato chip bin, or if there are any chocolate chip cookies left, is looking at that catalysts for change. You know, between the projects that are represented here, the use of data that's being collected, what we know about from our own individual personal and professional experience, can we take the conversation a little further in smaller groups or follow-ups with our panel to see what types of data we have? Maybe isn't being used properly, or isn't enough, or doesn't exist, but all of us smart people with intelligence and motivation together can figure it out. So let's thank the panel, thank our hosts, and continue to...